It is at dining tables, in our homes, during student-initiated programs, in restaurants around the city, and standing on food online at food trucks that so many of us learn what we have in common and those unique preferences and subtleties that distinguish us as individuals with multiple identities. Food is an important part of every culture. In all societies, food is the primary way of building and maintaining relationships. Thank you. I am often invited to receptions after officiating weddings in St. Paul's Chapel. Almost without fail, the abundance of food at the reception is explained with phrases like, Greeks love to eat, Italians love food, Persians set a bountiful table, Southern hospitality is defined by good food, the love of food is part of Jewish life. Food and hospitality define us all. Good food, good hospitality, and a great celebration are more and more often defined by local, farm fresh, sustainable, and organic foods, as better health and nutrition is on the minds of us all. Our conversation partner this evening is Chef Mario Batali. Chef Batali is not only an expert on Italian history and culture and the culture of Italian cuisine, he is one of the most recognized and respected chefs in America, indeed I would assert, in the world. Raised in Seattle, Washington, he spent his childhood watching his grandmother make Italian specialties passed down in his family. His signature dishes are made with much of the same simplicity and purity he saw in his grandmother's cooking, inspired by the quality of local produce. Chef Batali studied at Rutgers University and at Le Cordon Bleu in London. He accepted an apprenticeship with London's legendary chef Marco Pierre White and followed this with 3 years of intense culinary training in the northern Italian village of Borgo Capanne, outside Bologna in Italy. Having mastered the necessary skills and having acquired broad culinary experience, Chef Batali returned to the United States and over time succeeded in building restaurants and culinary businesses around the country and a reputation around the world. He is the owner of 17 restaurants, including Italy, a destination for food lovers. Students, how many of you have been there? Okay. Those of you who haven't been there, I'm giving you an assignment. You have to go there. Just get on the number one. Get off at 23rd. And prepare to stroll. When you're there, you feel like you're strolling around a small Italian village. Chef Batali is a talented chef who can be seen on television, you know, every network, but the Food Network in particular. He's the author of numerous cookbooks, including the New York bestseller, Mario Batali Italian Grill. His latest cookbook, Molto Batali, Simple Family Meals from My Home to Yours, was released this week and is available, signed copies for the first 30 or so this evening. Chef Batali is committed to giving back to the community and to those in need. He serves on the board of the Food Bank of New York. In 2008, he started the Mario Batali Foundation to educate and empower children, providing support for children's disease research, children's hunger relief, and literacy programs. In conversation with our chef this evening is Dr. Sharon Akabas, a 2010 Presidential Teaching Award recipient, acknowledged for her extraordinary contributions as an educator during her 15-year tenure here at Columbia. As the Institute of Human Nutrition's programs director, Dr. Akabas has developed many courses and training programs to educate healthcare professionals about the importance of nutrition and disease and the prevention of in disease prevention and treatment. Thank you so much for being here. Welcome to the conversation.
Thank you, Chaplain. So, first of all, it's an honor to be here, and we are all looking forward to this next hour of conversation with you. We wanted to just begin by asking you to take us from when you were a child, and then through college. I understand you were a short order cook, and then through your training in Italy, and now where you are, and just in about 30 seconds, no, we'll give you a little more.
I can do it.
Just take us through the high points of that and where you made your strongest connections to Italian culture and cuisine.
Born and raised in Seattle of third-generation Italian and French-Canadian immigrants. Lived in a lifestyle that seems she-she, but was probably more based on being in the lower part of the middle class. We pickled things, we made pies, we made sausage, we did all the things that are now trendy, and I thought it was because we were cool and Italian. In fact, we were just not as wealthy as we'd hoped we'd be. Very much tied to agrarian society at that point. My grandfathers on both sides were farmers, millers, and hop farmers. My father was the first of his family to go to college. He studied metallurgy and heat treatment and eventually became an engineer with Boeing. We moved to Spain the day that Franco died to work with Boeing. My father did. We lived in Spain in a relatively benign transition from 38 years of dictatorship into a social democracy. We were there at a time when burning garlic and overcooking meat was still trendy, so it wasn't all gourmet Spanish food like we think of it now. Came back, traveled a lot, got to see a lot of things, particularly Italian, Spanish, and Southern French food culture and kind of the strategies and the big differences between small towns and big cities. Came back to, for the first time in my life, came to the East Coast, went to Rutgers, loved it. Worked at a place called Stuff Your Face in New Brunswick, New Jersey. Exactly. Those who know, know. Their food is simple and fresh and very remarkably light for what it was or what it was sold as. They had two sizes of stromboli, large and huge, which is a big part of why it was so popular. Learned to live and love the idea of the adrenaline rush of a restaurant service where you go into an evening, you start, you prepare everything, then you get together and work very hard for 5, 6, 7 hours until the dinner service was over. And as a team, overcome a very, not necessarily difficult, but a very trying time, which is a kind of an adrenaline high every day, which was kind of the beginning of why I loved being in the restaurant business. Graduated college with a degree in Spanish theater of the Golden Age. A real career maker. Unfortunately, all the 17th century Spanish theaters were closed by the time I graduated college. But it was a good thing to study, and my suggestion always to anybody in college is not to look at it as a trade school, but to look at it as an opportunity to study something you won't ever really get a chance to study again. After that, I worked it wasn't like I was selected or applied for a slavery ship for Marco Pierre White. I kind of fell into it and worked for who eventually became the first English-born and youngest man or chef ever to win 3 Michelin stars. It was an incredible learning experience. You can learn a lot from somebody on how to behave, but also how not to behave. And then worked in California, and then worked in Italy in a tiny little town of 3.5 years outside of Bologna, and that's where I really learned that as much as you say about what goes on the plate, you can often say much more by not putting something else on the plate. And then I got to New York in 92, opened my first restaurant, Poe, in 93. And now I got to New York City with 2 dirty bags of clothes that I'd been holding on to since college and $300. And now I have $400. So it's been a good run.
Yeah.
New York's been very, very good to me.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so through that, what were some of the biggest challenges or frustrations that you experienced?
The frustrations are always the least of my worries. I find frustration when I am personally unsuccessful in helping somebody overcome something they want to overcome. In New York, it's frustrating. It was frustrating. The very first restaurant I got to was an old red sauce place called Rocco, and my college roommate, Arturo, and I decided to take over an old red sauce place and overnight transform it into a more modern interpretation of Italian cooking, not paying attention to the fact that everybody that came into that restaurant up until the day before we painted it had an expectation of classic Italian-American, simple spaghetti pomodoro and veal scallopini. And we changed it overnight without even thinking what we were doing and pretty much faced an empty restaurant for 3 or 4 months. And the frustration was not necessarily that the people weren't understanding me, but the frustration was perhaps in our ridiculous hubris in thinking that we could take an old red sauce place and change it overnight without bothering to tell anybody or warn them that things were coming, or perhaps maybe have made a more gradual transition from that to something that we thought was a little bit more relevant. That was probably the most frustrating time, because that was probably the, up until Poe was open for 6 months, I believe August 26, 1993, when Eric Asimov wrote a really nice under $25 per head review. Since then, most of my restaurants have been pretty much busy all the time. So in the time between I opened at Rocco and the 6 months after we opened at Poe, it was a little frustrating thinking maybe this wasn't, or I wasn't right for the city, or I didn't understand what the customers wanted, or they didn't understand me, which is a bad way to look at it. It was more that I couldn't figure out how to get traction and let the food that I wanted to be mine be theirs too. So the frustration was perhaps in the misinterpretation of what, how you should slowly announce yourself to your new customer base.
Okay. And now, if you could describe to us, we understand now from your book and from your most recent book that the family and the family setting, the family meal is what's really critical in part to the to your work and to your emphases. So can you describe to us a typical family meal in the Batali household?
Well, sure. Well, first let me just say that I grew up and we had family dinner every night. We were not a go out to dinner kind of family. We went out to dinner for like first communions or some kind of special occasion. But all the holidays were at our house. Every night dinner was on the table at 6 o'clock, except on Sunday when it was on the table at 4 o'clock. You were required to be there. You had clean hands and a clean shirt. That was kind of the rule. There was no variation. There wasn't even the idea of variation. So what we learned at that is that there's something constant that you can get pretty much every day. And whether you share your success or your lack of success that day, everybody discussed what was the best thing. I mean, one of my mom's favorite lines was, funniest thing that happened to you today, least funny thing that happened to you today, and who'd you sit with at lunch? And that was kind of where we had to go with every day. And that got the conversation rolling, and then eventually you'd start. What that conversation of course builds is the confidence to be able to share and understand both your success and your lack of success or your failures. But it also gives you some kind of a power and empowerment that there is somewhere you can go on a regular basis and discuss it. And that was a really big part of our lives. Now in the day when every kid has iBoy, Game Boy, iPhone, text message, instant text message, the 17 other codes that I don't know, they can now talk from Xbox whatever to Xbox whatever. There's a whole world of different potential interruptions in a dinner. So at our house, we make sure that everyone powers down, turns off, moves all it away. There's no TV on. There's no allowed to answer the door. There's no allowed to answer the phone. And although that seems relatively drastic, what we do get is between 30 minutes and an hour uninterrupted family time. And true to style, what was the funniest thing that happened to you today? What was the worst thing that happened to you today? And who'd you have lunch with? Is the beginning of the conversation. At our house on Sundays and Mondays, I usually cook. Sunday's kind of a classic Sunday supper, Italian style, or whatever, it depends. Mondays, we've embraced meatless Mondays, so we're not meat on Monday, and I cook that, and it's always a source of discussion why we weren't having meat, but generally to the satisfaction of the customers, the not-so-picky kids. Tuesday, because it's traditionally meatless Monday on our house, Tuesday's almost always known as Takeout Tuesday, and we'll order different foods in from the plethora of opportunities here. And then Wednesdays through Fridays, we have a babysitter who, well, they don't call her. Well, we actually, the boys at 15 and 13 still call her our babysitter. Her name is Leonora Maya. She is from outside of Acapulco and makes delicious Mexican food for us Wednesdays, Thursdays, and Fridays. And if you know me, or if you don't, I can tell you that my favorite thing to eat is anything anyone else makes. So Wednesdays, Thursdays, and Fridays, it's rare that I will not only be there, but I'll also eat. Saturdays and Sundays are a little bit, I mean, Saturdays are a little bit more of a role in the whatever. The kids always have a bunch of sports, and we end up somewhere, but then I go to work, so. But also Wednesdays, Thursdays, and Fridays after dinner, I go to work and go to the restaurants and see who I have to see and go in the kitchens and hang around. So after dinner's over, I generally go out and go to work and then come back later on when they're asleep.
So we shouldn't have the impression that you only eat Italian food.
Oh, no. This is New York City. There's over 10,000 restaurants here, all great.
So what are the common themes across foods that help us understand culture and the kinds of cultural set, you know, atmosphere you're trying to describe?
That's an interesting point. I think one of the great things in the kind of diversity in the back of the house, in the there's the front of the house and the back of the house, the waiters and the managers and the bartenders in the front of the house, the cooks, the busboys, and the dishwashers in the back of the house. It's interesting when you hire cooks who have gone to, say, the CIA and were born to a certain level of comfort in America, and whose families in the 80s and 90s when they were growing up didn't necessarily cook so much or went out to restaurants, particularly if they're urban New York City kids, don't always eat at home, they go out to restaurants or they have a different experience. But the guys that we hire and the gals that we hire from Latin America and Mexico and even South America, every day their mom or someone in their family cooks something from scratch. So it's much more likely that you will hire a Latino who will already have an intuition to understanding what really good cooking is because he or she has been around the smell and the work going forward to it. So it changes the way that we kind of look at how the staff works. And suddenly the people who may have come from the higher levels of income and education are not necessarily in charge. They're learning from the guys who may not have ever gone to high school. And although they speak perfect Spanish and perfect English and had a much more difficult voyage to get here by either coyote or sneaky bus, they're really in charge because they really have more information. So it's an interesting way to kind of distinguish the cultural rites that go on in the back of the house. And the front of the house is still predominantly run by upper middle class kids.
So at the end of the meal, it sounds like also, or even in the restaurant, you try to create a space for people to sit and speak and talk so that food is the center, but it's really about the communication and the community. Can you talk a little bit about
that? Well, you mean in amongst the restaurant staff? Absolutely, as well as in the family. And that's what, it's strange. At 4:15, at all the between 4 and 4:15, all the restaurants sit down to what we call family meal. And family meal is made by one of the chefs. We generally post the menu a month in advance so you can know what's coming at. We always have either a veg or a non-veg and a main course meat entree. And people sit down, they discuss it. We chit-chat about our normal experiences, and then we have family meeting, which is kind of like a Quaker meeting in that you can pretty much say whatever you want or you don't have to say anything. But we also discuss any errors or flaws in our strategy and our services of the last couple of days or things that we want to polish up on. And that's a time that we use a lot to let people know in the staff of the rich tradition of the Italian table and culture and the ingredients and the regionality of it. And it's just a way to kind of promulgate the ideology of the Italian extra specialness at the table. And often it's about a product or it's about tasting a wine with a particular cheese, but understanding that for a lot of Americans up until 15 years ago, Italian food was spaghetti, lasagna, and pizza. And now everyone, as we become more sophisticated, understands that there's 21 regions and that the piadina from Romagna, although it is in fact a bread-like product, is not the same as a pizza or a calzone from the south or as something else like a carta di musica from Sardinia. So our job is to know that, and the reason that we want to know that is to purvey a calm sense of informational flow to the customer should they require it. A lot of times what will happen at a restaurant, you'll sit down and someone will come over and introduce themselves and tell you all about the things on the menu, and if you ask one little question, they'll answer it in a much longer winded way than you'd hoped. The understanding of what a really great restaurant is that the most sacred no-fly zone is between the shoulders of the guests at a particular table. And if they need you, you can come in and you can answer any question you want. But by no means should the temple or the genuflection at the temple of the chef become the most important part. When I go out to dinner with my friends, I certainly want to eat a really good meal, and I'm fascinated by many of the things there. But probably I want the bigger conversation to happen between me and my guests. Not necessarily between me and the staff of the restaurant who are excited that we're there and want to do their best job. So the understanding of what a really great restaurant can do is they can come in when you need them, but they can also sit back and let you have a good time. Now, a lot of people go and they want to know a lot about the experience, and it's always a constant dialogue, and we're prepared for that. But learning it to become really good is also to let them be where they are when they want. So we discuss that during our pre-meal family meal all the time. And it's the nuance of what a great or good restaurant can and should be and how we evolve it and move it so that we stay up with the times and up with the people and the customer's expectation.
So let's come back to time again, because it sounds like it's a very valuable commodity, one that
the most valuable.
And so if you were in charge of food and nutrition in this country, how would you weave that into your policy?
Well, I think that I'm on the board of Food Bank for New York, and Food Bank for New York provides about a million three meals a day in New York City alone, all five boroughs. And the biggest problem is not one of the production of food. We definitely make enough food. We improperly distribute it and most likely waste most of it. And that is even to the level of a grocer getting a box of carrots and throwing away 10% of them because they don't look uniform enough that they think the customer might say, well, I'm not spending $1.49 on that carrot. It doesn't look as good as that carrot. So they weed them out, and in fact, they don't necessarily even take them to a better place. They don't even make soup stock out of them. They just get them out of the way because they just raise the price. So our distribution is our biggest problem. And it's because there are no incentives for you to do anything with that carrot if it doesn't quite make your level. Or, you know, the tens of thousands of tons of cherries that lay on the ground in fact, they realize that the cherry price will go down if you harvest them all. So to maintain a higher level of general cherry price, you throw away a lot because it doesn't make sense to pick them because you won't get any more money. So you've reached your marginal cost. I mean, back to ECO 101, your marginal revenue and your marginal cost curves at your production number, which is a ridiculous thing in food. It's maybe good for widgets, but in food, you should harvest everything and make something out of it, and then you should either give it to someone or sell it to them. The fundamental mantra of all of my businesses is, what do we do in the kitchen? And if, as long as you're doing this, you will never be fired. We buy stuff, we fix it up, and we sell it for profit. And if you understand that fundamental idea, you're going to go a long ways, because a lot of people buy stuff, fix it up, and throw it away, or buy stuff and don't fix it up and throw it away, or buy stuff and eat it because it looks good. The restaurant needs to be a place where the business has to happen. Back to my general food policy, we'd have to create incentives for farmers to grow things. I think the fundamental error in America is to have perceived themselves since, say, the end of the Korean War, that we have become a service society. And service is great, but not when you have 300 million people, because there's just not enough service to go around. What the true strength of an economic recovery for us should be, and you can see this kind of speckled throughout in the fact that Detroit has come back from an absolute crap can to something that's actually producing things. If Americans can actually make stuff with their hands and sell it to other people, including other Americans, will realize that we have a more evolved race. We have a better way of making things, and as long as we understand that quality eventually will get its price, then that's where we need to go. And we need to get back into production, because shipping it out isn't working, and not making stuff isn't working, and trade deficits are creating the most bizarre upside-down economic world in the world. And also, we're reliant on somebody else's energy. So even though they hate us, we still call them, and we still buy stuff from them. So at the end of the day, the first thing we need to do is figure out alternate sources of sustainable energy. Then we have to grow all the stuff that we can and give it to the people that can't afford it. And third of all, go back to the kind of fixing table and start to produce things here that will command a fair price on the international market, because, again, it's American made, which used to be the standard of glory. Now it's Chinese made is kind of the standard of glory, and we're wondering how and why we got beat.
So we're going to open this up in a few minutes to questions, but I think one of the other things everybody would be interested in is you're extremely successful and you're extremely committed to giving back. In your program, you'll see that there's a matching opportunity, and you've been very generous to offer a very high level of matching if we go to a particular site that's in the program. But you must have people coming at you from all directions. How have you decided upon the three main areas that you're going to focus on?
As a restaurateur with a group of customers as vast as New York, what a regular customer, or even a customer that you've only met once, will come in and say, listen, my daughter's school is having an auction. Can you donate something? Or our hospital is having a fundraiser. Or our symphony is this. Or literally, we get between 100 and 200 requests for a charitable contribution every week in my office. And that's not my partner Joe's office, who probably gets a lot as well. So we have to figure out, and you know, we were just kind of piecing it together, and if we really knew the person, we'd give them something. If we didn't really know them, we'd try to figure out a way. But at the end of the day, what we were doing is giving out between $1 million and $3 million of product a year, but without any real focus on where it was going or what it was doing. It was good because it was philanthropy, but it was not good because it wasn't really pushing forward any thoughtful agenda of putting $3 million is nothing in the large spec. For someone like me, it's a lot of money, and for someone who's on the recipient end, it's even more. Because, wow, they get $20,000 or they get something that they can sell for $100,000. Like, we do these silly dinners with me and Tom Colicchio and David Chang, and they go for 10 people, they go for $175,000 at like a Clinton event. And it's because those guys really just want to hang out with Clinton, and they'll suffer through a dinner with us. And that's all right, it's a great way to trade it up. But what we realized is, well, what's really important, and what do we think are the kind of building blocks of what good philanthropy should be? And it occurred to me that the greatest thing that we have is the potential in the children that are here. And how to remove the most obvious obstacles. Keep in mind, when we're talking about hunger relief, the fundamental issue is one of awareness. People just aren't aware of what poverty looks like. The face of poverty looks very much like the face of people in this room. There is the working poor, there are people that are destitute and simply kind of disenfranchised. There are a lot of people who are trying very hard to make it and just can't make it on whatever income they have with the number of family members that they have. So hunger is, first of all, the most obviously curable. It's not like cancer, it's not like leukemia. We don't have to look very far. To cure hunger, we merely need to get a grocery basket full of stuff and put it in front of someone, and they will no longer be hungry right then and there for that hour. And if you do it every day, then they're no longer hungry ever. And then they can start thinking about something more importantly than just getting their belly filled. So the first one was hunger relief, particularly children's hunger relief. Then disease research for children's diseases, because there's a certain level of innocence and seeing that that is also the least funded. We go for really abstract diseases, ones that are also very small, because I find that to give somebody $50,000 for some kind of research when it's just starting seems to get a bigger bang for the buck, and it feels a lot nicer. And then literacy guarantee, which you would be surprised, but most Americans aren't aware that we have about a 12% illiteracy rate in America, which is extraordinarily high, what I think. So those were the three that I decided to really go after. And the beauty of literacy is that as opposed to sending money, we can give books and I can give my time. So we built a library and now we're building another one, and we work on this whole idea where everybody that works in the restaurants, if they want to come down, they can read books to people who don't know how to read, and it makes them feel good. It gives them a certain social justice component to their lives, and it makes them feel like they're participating, which is good. The disease research we just put together, my foundation this year is going to come up with about $1 million. We're going to figure out probably $250,000 grants and then a bunch of $50,000 grants, because we like to get in on the early side. And hunger relief, I work with the food bank, and everyone in the restaurants is like more than likely to go down and help at the food banks, not just on Thanksgiving when most people do, but on other days at least once or twice. Three times a quarter, if you can do it once a month, it's a really nice thing. Working in a soup kitchen makes you feel really good. And what you really see is that hunger isn't some abstract, weird thing out of a Dickens book, but it's actually like just about all the people you see on the street could easily be hungry. So we focused all of those three at the Mario Batali Foundation. And we do events and we sell these dinners to these Clinton fat cats or whoever else. And that generates the cash that we then work on. With this book, we've decided that if people want to participate, we will give them a percentage of the proceeds of the book, as well as match any donations that people do when they see this. And I'm lucky enough to go on shows like Piers Morgan last night, or Good Morning America tomorrow, or any one of 30 or 40 shows that are likely to have cooks come on and make David Letterman swig some Chianti or whatever. But it works out well because it's entertainment, but there's also some kind of social value to it. And the awareness of that and flashing that little URL underneath there really helps people get involved and play on it. So it's a good thing to do, but it also feels really good.
So giving back is really central to
When I say give back, I think one of the fundamental things we have to think back about is giving. And I think when I talk to all of the young adults in this room, I would say that if you were going to ask me what you think, or what I think you should do, either the year you graduate or during one of the summer breaks, go do something for someone you never met. You're not giving back, you're giving. And giving unconditionally is an entirely different feeling. And giving back implies that you took. And although I've been enjoying the fruits of our society, I've worked hard to get where I was, so it's not like I snuck anything by. I think the idea is just give. And when people ask me what they should do after college, go work at the Peace Corps. Go build somebody something. Go do something for someone you've never met in your life and see how that feels for a year. That gives you perspective on where we are in the real world. And that also helps you understand that maybe it's not just a hedge fund that might be a good idea for a good job. Although getting rich on a hedge fund and giving out billions of dollars is a really interesting idea too. So it's with joy and optimism that I look out over a room like this, because every one of you guys has the opportunity to not only do something for society, but for yourself, but for your family, and for your eventual children and family, or not. But the idea is to use the influence and advantage that you have, not for anything, sometimes for things that aren't mapped out. Like, just give and give. And that's kind of where that joy of that and being a part of that becomes a really big part of the cake. And that's what I'm trying to do. So it's not giving back, although giving back is good. Giving is also good.
I agree. Good. So we're going to now open this to all of you. And I think we're going to ask anyone who has a question for Mario to come to the microphone.
Come on, someone's got something to say. There we go. Hi.
I'm just concerned about, you know, the growing epidemic of obesity in America, and also eating disorders, you know, on both ends. And I, you know, I'm just curious about your thoughts about Americans' relationship with food. And also I want you to throw in your thoughts about fast food as you reflect on this topic.
Well, fast food, to start, is generally made from the things that they won't be able to sell anywhere else. When McDonald's buys its beef, it's beef. And if you're familiar with the USDA and how they judge and qualify and quantify beef, there's the prime, and then there's choice, and then there's good, and then there's pretty good, and then there's kind of good, and then there's fast food, which is at the same level as animal feed, which is okay. It's not bad. But what they do, and the most heinous crime, of course, is the overprocessing of food. And I think the problem in America with obesity isn't necessarily that we're overnourished or that we've eaten too many of any particular kind of calorie. What we've eaten are bad calories, bereft of any nutrition or fiber. And because of that, you can eat a lot more of them. If you go to McDonald's and you eat the Happy Meal, which isn't so happy. But it's about, I think they're about $7 in New York, $7 or $8 right now for a Happy Meal. So you think you're saving money. A dinner for four, if you even go to the fanciest store I know, which is Italy, and you buy a chicken and salad and one or two vegetable courses and even a simple pasta that you're just gonna toss with a little pesto, you can get out of there for $24. The fast food myth, and it's inexpensive, kind of the way they play it in the sociology classes, well, they're saving money, that's why they're doing it. They're gonna go figure it out and it's gonna cost less. It isn't less expensive. It's less expensive because people aren't paying for all of the problems that they're gonna face. And the way that we look at all of our things when we talk about nutrition and health, you're either gonna pay for it now or you're gonna pay for it later. And that's America's way of dealing with it. And our strategy with healthcare and our strategy with taking care of people that are sick is we'd rather let them get sick and then fix them, then let them know that it's a lot easier not to get sick just by taking care of your machinery. So fast food, bad. Home cooked food, good. Sharing it with people you know, better. So there are not very many complicated rules here. But if you understand also that our reliance on protein has driven us to a slightly odd place. If you can push protein out of the very center of the plate and concentrate every day on smaller portions of protein. I mean, when you go to Italy and you go to France and you go to Spain, there are big people, but there's no really big people. And it's because for some strange reason, even though they're trying to embrace our 60s, 70s, and 80s ways of eating, they can't do it that quickly. They still eat vegetables on a regular basis. They don't get giant portions. There's no 28-ounce steak, eat it all, it's on us restaurants in Europe, or whatever the number is these days. We have been taught, only in America is overeating considered an act of heroism. The rest of the world looks at eating as an act of nutrition and an act of maintaining the way you go. So we have some fundamental and long-lasting problems none of which the fault is the people that are doing the eating. It's a lot about big business, big farming, big fast food, and our manipulation of both our sugar and our corn. I mean, Michael Pollan's written very well on the manifest destiny of corn and corn sugar solids. And it's a very interesting way to look at things. But the answer is people need to start shopping and cooking at their house. And when they do that, they'll find that their health will eventually improve and relatively quickly. So that's my tiny little prescription. Yes, ma'am.
For those of us who are interested in pursuing careers in the culinary industry, what is your best piece of advice and how we can go about achieving that?
It depends. Are you interested in the restaurant industry or the overall food world?
Not sure.
Okay, well, good. Then study anything that makes you feel good right now and be an A student. And when you're done, go work in something that seems like where you'd like to be for free for 6 months. Anybody will take someone who has insurance for 6 months for free to test drive it. The uninsured, however, become an issue because there's a lot of people out there that aren't. And there's a whole mess of litigious skanks out there who would love to sue us for letting someone work for our restaurant for free. So what you need to do is figure out whether it's a magazine or whether it's a dietitian facility or whether it's sports medicine or whether, I mean, there's a thousand ways to get involved in the field. Find one that you think is the one that you'd likely enjoy the most, because I can tell you one thing. Of all of my college roommates, perhaps Greg Ostroff and I have nailed it the best, in that when I am at work, it's never like I'm looking at my clock thinking, oh, gee, another hour and I got to go home. It's more like, I should have gone home 2 hours ago. Because I never go to work a day in my life. When you love what you do, you are never at work. You are always enjoying it. It's kind of like being in college. Except they pay us. So find something that you like and then dally in it. Like spend the next summer, if you want to be at Food & Wine magazine and you write Dana Cowan or Kay Crater and say, Mario Batali said I could call you and I could come work in your place for free. They'll say, yes, are you insured? And you'll say, yes, I am. I'm happy to come in on my own dime. I just want to be a fly on the wall, or I want to help you guys do something. And in a restaurant, in a magazine, in a soup kitchen, in a food service facility like at a college here, or a grease truck, or any one of the places, they'll always take on free labor, and you will learn a lot about that experience, and you will also learn a lot about your potential for happiness doing that. And that's most importantly what you really have to do is say, can I see myself doing this for 30 years? And I don't think there's any of us, I mean, I didn't think I could do anything for 30 years, and now I'm old, and look, I'm still doing it.
Thank you.
Sure. Hi.
My name is Carly Bird. I'm a student actually in public health and also studied nutrition with Sharon, Dr. Akabas. I worked in the mayor's office this summer and learned a lot about urban agriculture policy. So I have two questions for you. Is urban ag policy or urban agriculture part of your hunger relief efforts? And can you just talk about that a little bit more? And also, can I have reservations on Saturday at Babo?
Let me just tell anybody who wants a reservation the deal. The phone reservationists have the city by the cojones. Every single restaurant in New York City, particularly on a Saturday, someone called a month ago and booked up all the tables. The first group got the 8 o'clocks, which is what they want. The second group took the 6 o'clocks, and the third group took the 10 o'clocks. The 10 o'clocks aren't going to give it up because they love it. The 8 o'clocks, they might find something better to do. The people that went to the 6 o'clock reservation did so begrudgingly and have spent the next 2 weeks trying to find somewhere better. So what happens in the 6 o'clock seating is almost 20% are no-shows. Now, in all of my restaurants, except for Del Posto, there are tables to sit down for unreserved reservations, meaning people that just walk in. But there's also all the people that just didn't bother to show and didn't call. So don't be dissuaded by the phone person saying it's impossible to get in here, because it isn't. If you walk in with a smile and don't lie and pretend that you have a reservation and say, Mario said that if I came here and smiled and tipped the bartender heavily on my first drink, you will be seated. And heavily isn't that heavy, $10. You buy 2 glasses of wine for 25 bucks and you throw an extra 10 down and you smile and you look at the maitre d'. And you have established a relationship that will not be broken.
Thanks.
Urban agriculture is a huge idea, and we have talked for a long time about trying to help it get kicked in. What I am trying to lead it towards is use of unusable, previously considered unusable. I would love to support a roof garden plan. The idea of taking these kind of beat up corners of the inner city gardens and helping them try to revitalize is, in my opinion, a waste of my time because it's already there and no one's doing anything with it. So me to put my brand on it or to give somebody some seeds is maybe a stopgap. It's a halfway gig. Helping somebody or a group of people from a fine institution like this, helping them in brand and in financing say, listen, we know, just fly over the city. There are thousands and thousands of acres of something that could support a small level of dirt, a watering program. And for me, that is a far more intriguing place and a place where we could affect not only New York City and not only America, but the world. And understanding when you go to Rome and you get into the train station or you get into the airport and you drive in, you will not see a 10-foot plot that is not planted all the way from the airport through what looks like nothing. Everything is planted because they look at the soil as a gift, and we should be able to figure out a way to do that. So that I recommend that, and if that is your plan of action, you can talk to Pam Louie right there or David Gruber right there in my office, and they're the front two right there looking at me with the cameras. And we will help you figure it out. We are committed to this idea and down with it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Esther. I firstly want to say thank you for coming. And I love your show.
Thank you. My
question was, you mentioned about supporting different ways of production. And I was wondering if you can speak more about that, if you support GMO foods, how you feel about the organic food movement.
Well, I think that goes back to we're either going to pay for it now or we're going to pay for it later. Organic and untainted food supply is going to be the hot button much more quickly than we imagine. And we are all about supporting local organic farmers and also not shipping them very far. And the same spreads to animal husbandry and understanding that whatever we're putting in that stuff is going to be in us very quickly. So we're big supporters of organic. We're big supporters of however they can get whatever kind of certification that they have, but we also support farmers that can't get certification because of their proximity to a bigger farm right next to them who's simply not going to take those same steps. So although they can't get the official stuff, we know that their produce and whatever they're making is on the right ideology with us, and that's more interesting to us than the actual certification itself. Eventually, however, though, this whole discussion is about internalizing costs for companies that don't want to. And if they're forced to, their quickest answer is to pass it on to the customer. If they're short-minded, if they're not thinking very far into the future, they'll immediately pass that on and possibly strangle out the customer who doesn't understand why one carrot's a buck and another one's three. So there needs to be, and this goes back to my taking over the entire farm policy of the United States, the subsidies that we spend on artificially maintaining a price for a certain product by having people not grow stuff should be immediately shit canned, and we should figure out a way that they could grow something to give to somebody on some level. And making those new fallow farms into something that is organic or at least attempting to be organic is a much quicker way to health than by telling everybody that they should exercise another 30 minutes today.
Thank you.
Sure. Although the exercise is a key part of it, don't get me wrong.
Hi. I guess this is a good follow-up question. Do you think there is a contradiction between sustainability and local and organic foods?
I don't know if it's a contradiction. I know that in this part of the country, if you want to have local food, you better stock up in December because there's nothing coming out of our dirt from the last pumpkin until the first ramp. There is a history in all parts of the world that you would preserve stuff for the season that you couldn't get it. Unfortunately, that is kind of, it's vogue in a Ruth Reichel kind of way, but it's not vogue in a outside of the Kansas State Fair and all the great state fairs of America. It's not so much a habit as it was when I was growing up. And now pickles are coming back and preserved things are hip and cool and it's coming a long way, but sustainable means more than just being able to save for the next dead season. It's about how we approach our farming and it's about how we approach our water use and understanding that again, the next hot topic in addition to food safety is water access. And that we have so far somehow been able to allow companies like Nestle and Coca-Cola to take the water from underneath our houses and sell it back to us in these bottles is the most perplexing piece of policy I could ever figure. So what we have to do initially is take the natural resources away from the individual person and put them into the aggregate. Water is our resource. The air is our resource. And charging people to use it and charging people to sell it to us is the way that we can fatten our coffers to make the right decisions and more or less fund the kind of radical thought process that it's going to take. In Nation's Restaurant News last week, I had to laugh. There was a big, long, what looked like an article calling me out on being part of the radical fringe by suggesting people eat meat one day less a week, as if I was some, you know, terrorist with a bomb. And we wrote them back a little note saying, and after we found out that he was on a PAC committee for beef production, obviously. You couldn't tell by his signature or anything, but you could tell by his words. And the big thing is that you have to beat the big farm lobby first. And that's just us telling them. And the only way that you can vote is by going to the grocery store and buying those organic things. Sustainable is another step, and we got to figure that out in seafood. We got to figure that out in kind of the way that we plant and work with our own water. But these are dreams that work well if the farmers markets are rocking. So as long as you're buying stuff at the farmers markets all summer long and you're also helping them at the end of the summer buying their bumper crops and pickling and hanging and doing the right thing, then we're on a path that's away from toward the fast food lines, which is where we've gone since when I was a kid till about 5 years ago.
Thanks.
Sure.
Hi.
So
I have that's good. I have two questions. One of them is... Thanks, sorry.
No problem.
So you speak really fondly about having family time and family meals and, it's important. What's your advice for people who are super busy working in school and still want to have that family time and connect with their parents, kids, and all of that?
The only way to... It's probably not conceivable that a family that's really busy and is used to eating at different times and kind of just getting their nutrition from the house is going to change next week to have 7 family meals. But if you want to start with one. Say Tuesday night or Sunday night or whatever night seems to be the one that you might be able to make it happen. Choose that night the week in advance. And then to lure them in, make their favorite dish that night. Because if you say every Tuesday's lasagna night, pretty soon in their mind, they start refocusing their day, whatever their favorite dish is. It could be anything. But they start to refocus around it and they think about the meal before they're hungry, which is how they're thinking about it now. A lot of times, getting everyone to focus on one thing is because they're thinking that their squash practice or their study hall or their choir gig or whatever it is that they're doing, or just some relaxing time playing computer games or Facebooking with their friends is got priority. But when priority comes down and all of a sudden you can help them focus, start with one meal a week. When I was growing up and my mom went back to work when I was 9, she didn't work up until then after we were born. And one of the big things in our house was every week, each of us, 9-year-old, brother 8-year-old, sister 6-year-old, had to create a shopping list and an item for a menu that we were going to make ourselves. Now, it could be Swanson chicken pot pies. It could have been TV dinners. You guys don't even know what TV dinners are, I imagine. But there were these cool little trays with all the not so good food, but it was a great idea. We could get TV dinners. Or we could actually make something like soup or spaghetti with tomato sauce. And putting the onus on some of the people in the house to make the dinner also gave people great pride when someone would come and eat your food. So you were much more enthusiastic about going and eating someone else's food. So there's the bait and switch trick, which is give them something that they want, and the switch trick, which is have them make a dinner and say, listen, I'll show up if you make your dinner as long as you show up when I make my dinner. Cool. Two?
Yeah. So when you guys film Internship America, mm-hmm. I was just curious, is it done really in real time?
And it's real
time. You produce this amazing stuff in just such a short period of time.
Well, I'll tell you how that happens. I decide what I'm going to make no matter what ingredient they're going to give me. So I know I'm going to work on the Sicilian street food, or I'm going to make food from Vietnam, or whatever is inspiring me that week. And I've been working with Mark Ladner and Anne Burrell since we started, since the very first battle I was on. And we decide and we practice. The day before we do a shoot, we make stuff. We don't know what's going in it, but we make like the base. Like we make a pasta with some kind of sauce that is Sicilian for us. And then if they give us tuna, well, then we make tuna meatballs or we make whatever it is. What we have to do, however, is pack in some, we're allowed $200 worth of pantry ingredients. So I make sure there's always calamari, there's always scampi or shrimp, there's always rabbit, there's always some proteins. If for some strange reason they gave us apples, which they never did. They always gave me the big fish you had to kill and then cut up into pieces. The genius of the way we operated is that Mark Ladner, the tall guy that's the chef and partner of Del Posto, he was fascinated by with whatever he got, and his job, I don't know if you watched and noticed there was a kind of a strategy, Mark always did the butchering. He broke it down. So if it was tuna, if you notice, we went up against that guy Ludo, a very sexy dude from Los Angeles. And he took the loin and did five things with it. Mark gave me the collar, he gave me the cheeks, he gave me the meat at the tail, he gave me the belly, he gave me six different things to work with. So that alone was going to beat him. Because we were more imaginative in our use of the original ingredient. So we just think that way. But it was definitely a work of three people. And Anne always did the noodles and the little funny garnishes and the funny sauces and all that stuff. And then I just kind of pulled it all together. I had the easiest job of all, except I had to carry the tuna across the room and chop his head off.
Cool. Thank you so much.
Sure.
Chef Batali, hello.
Hi.
I'm a student of international relations here. And already tonight, you've given a great lesson on coalition building, as you walk into a bar, leave a big tip, and you know, get the reservation that you want.
Right.
I wonder if you might have, from your travels, from your business, I wonder if you have any other lessons on international relations that you've learned at the table or other places.
I would say that the simple act of trying what is, a lot of times travelers, international travelers, will go and they will look for the fanciest three-star, or whatever their price point is, they will immediately go to the top of that level and figure that that must be the best of wherever they're going to go. And the people that you're traveling to experience that with, and when I say international relations, I'm not necessarily talking about governments, I'm talking about companies working together and people going out on a call and trying to figure out how best to get whatever product they're buying from wherever they are to wherever they got to make it so they can make something else and sell it somewhere else. The best thing you can do is find the local food that expresses the joy of the people that are right there, born there. What happened in the Michelin guide system, which became a very influential guide in the 60s and 70s and still is they decided to reward luxury, what's perceived as luxury. Caviar, smoked salmon, foie gras, ingredients that don't really have any place other than where they're born. But you would go to these restaurants knowing and that you could eat well and you could eat high end and it would be impressive to all the guests to do that. Well, what occurred to me is that why would I go to a place that virtually guarantees that the super rich can eat the same thing wherever they go, which are these luxury items. So what you do is you find and search out the local traditions and the local foods and the local expressions of whatever it is, whether it's apple strudel or ginger beer or whatever it is. And if you share that with the people that you're with, you will find that suddenly the bonds and the division starts to break down, because not only are you doing something together, but you're doing something that represents the way the dirt smells here on a Thursday when the wind blows right by it, when you're picking an apple or being a part of it. And what I've found is that the most unrecognized and yet powerful ties of any group of people anywhere is to the agriculture that they're around, regardless of what they think. That's what they really are tied to. And when they have their real specialties, it's something that's from around here. And sharing that with people is the easiest way to become close friends with them. Because the act of that sharing is the most personal thing that you do with your family. And even though you're not thinking about it in that way, that's where it's going.
Thank you.
Sure.
Hello, Chef.
Hi.
I'm Sam Akabas. I learned nutrition in Sharon's home kitchen. Hi, Mom.
Hi, Sam.
There were two.
And how's it been? You look
pretty
great.
Good. Thank you.
It's working well.
There were two points that you touched on earlier. One was about incentivizing people to produce the right quality good and distribute it to the right market. And the other was about how countries are adopting more of the industrial agricultural model, moving to 1 to 5,000 acre farms and CAFOs, et cetera. And at the same time, they're speaking out of the other side of their mouths and hiring chefs through their agricultural ministries like Rene Redzepi and Farinaggio. So I'm curious to learn where you think there's opportunity there and where you see that that debate evolving.
Well, big money will always be very intriguing to someone who doesn't have big money, and chefs are in that group. So when a huge Monsanto comes to a guy or a gal who's cooking in a great restaurant with 30 seats in Copenhagen and says, why don't you become the spokesperson for our genetically modified seed product? And I'll tell you why, because it tastes good. And I'll tell you why, because I can make it less expensive. And I'll tell you why, you don't really have to do much. You just have to give us your name and a couple recipes with these seeds, and it's all right. And that's a compelling story when they throw $500,000 at you, when you've never made 150 grand in a year that you can remember. So what you have to hope is that Rennie thinks to himself, I'm in a unique position of influence right now. Should I take the money right now, or should I take it over time? And some people are going to take it right now. And the answer to the genetic modification is that it may, in fact, not kill us. But have we tested it? And how can we vet out the proper understanding of it before it becomes a problem that we look back and say, oh, yeah, I remember when there were 320 million Americans, and then we let all those seeds come in, and now we're down to 130 million. And you see J.G. Ballard writing the book, right? I mean, the whole thing's happening right now. And the movie's being played, you know, done, and Cormac McCarthy's part of this playwright, and the whole, I mean, you can see the whole postmodern thing coming. But it's probably not going to play out like that. And what it really comes down to is individual decisions inform individual ways of life. And it's as a collective that we can make things happen, not necessarily by binding together and go sitting down in Zuccotti Park, because that's not a bad idea, but it's not very effective. And although it's getting some press, and you know, Kanye was down there last week, it's not really changing. The guys in Wall Street are hardly trembling in their boots right now trying to figure out what it is, nor are the Monsanto guys. So what it really takes is a small grassroots effort to become a bigger grassroots effort, and those grassroots efforts become important just like a great song does. If there's something that resonates in it, that means in your mind that you recognize the core greatness of a small idea, and you want to listen to the song a lot because you hear that harmony, or you want to be a part of that group because it makes sense to you. That's where we're at. And I must say, as children of the most weaselly group of all time, the hedge fund people that are all right. I mean, I know a lot of them, and they were a lot of them were in my class at school, and I didn't want to give them the keys to the car then, and I still don't want them to have the keys to the car. But that said, the generation right now, your guys' age and the next 12 or 15 years down to my kids and their friends, are thinking about these decisions. And when they buy products and when they evaluate the decision making, they're thinking about, is this a philanthropic company and are these guys taking care of our environment? So that seed has been planted, and it's just by following through and executing it in a way that makes sense. But you're voting with your dollars at the end of the day, and that's how things have to happen. I kind of got around to it, didn't I? All right.
Hi. I have two quick questions. Sure. The first one is, do you think that putting food and making sure that the family eats at the table will help enhance childhood education or literacy and help promote promote values such as that? That's my first question. And my second question is, how are your relationships between the other chefs that you work with at Iron Chef America?
You mean the ones I beat?
The
other Iron Chefs, like, yes. Bobby and Michael, yeah. And I think 15 years ago, chefs in the same town might have been a little bit more contentious and may not have bonded together as well. But we're lucky in a town like New York City, where there's enough customers to go around that you don't have to beat someone to do well. So my relationships are great with them. I don't yet know Mark Forgione, but all the other guys and gals I've met, and I get along with them really well. I mean, we don't have to fight each other, so it makes it a little easier to love. The question about bonds growing at the table, I don't think it's an answer for any single question. What it creates in children who can have a consistent experience around a meal with their elders or their brothers and sisters or their nieces and nephews or their aunts and uncles, anybody in their family, it will create a self-confidence that makes them less likely to shy away from a challenge or a problem and give them the ability and the thought process that they can probably get over it with or without support. And I think that's the fundamental grain of information about family meals. It doesn't cure everything, but it creates a confidence in the child's mind that things are not insurmountable. And I think that's what it comes down to.
Thank you.
Sure.
So I have to be the teacher here and say this is going to be our last question. I think we can try to...
Okay, let's go last three. I'll go
okay,
all three.
Okay,
last three.
I'm good with that. Go. All right. We'll do a lightning round.
Hi,
I like
Batali.
That.
Hi. My name is Mala, and I'm one of Dr. Akabas' students at the IHN. And we've done a lot discussing accessibility to food and the food environment. And I was wondering what kind of strategies or simple recommendations you would make to a low-income family in the city that's trying to make a healthy or lifestyle change, given that healthier foods are often much more expensive and less accessible, especially given that areas in the city are essentially food deserts.
Right. I've been working with the Food Bank for New York, and we have created a, what do we call it?
Cookshop.
We've created a cookshop class for children and their parents to come in and identify what are the 10 or 15 most often found categories at either a food bank or a food pantry or a supportive gifting place where you can go get free food under any other guise. And it's how to use it, it's how to identify the products, and how to combine them in a way that makes sense. Understanding that protein is probably the trickiest one of those, and fresh produce is the second trickiest of those. Understanding that you can combine beans and rice and other things along with vegetables to make things. It's really about education in a place where education is really hard to hand them. So there is no panacea, nor is there an easy answer, but certainly the more the food pantries and food kitchens can participate in describing the decisions that you're making, the more likely they are to realize that they're actually making a decision. Sometimes it's just, all right, I get 5 reds, 3 yellows, and 2 greens, and you take what looks like the biggest, which would be the way I would shop too. Understanding that there's more strategic uses of some of those foods is the first step to understanding that. And it is not a delicious and nor is it an entirely optimistic prognosis that we have right now. The trick is to help find more people get more food from places we know it's being made to those kinds of locations. And that's kind of a macro look and kind of a cop-out because it's not going to change anything on Thursday next week. But letting them understand that the decisions they make are affecting them is a big thing. And helping them feel slightly empowered by making the right decision is the way to go.
Thank you.
Sure.
My name is Maria Paola Sutto. I work at the Urban Design Lab here at Columbia University, and we study food as well. We study food. We just had a report on urban agriculture, and then we study the regional localization of food. We look at the farmers, the young innovative farmers, and how they look at the city, because we all say the city, but the poor farmers who have to drive 5 hours to come every time at the farm market, how do they react to this? Let's say we hope that it's not a fad, but all this movement of interest in food. And then the latest is, the national, how the localization can become a big thing and be local all over national and reestablish a different concept of this very complex system that's a food system. Period. Finished. I came to pick up on your offer to make the green roof because we really have very little money. We have every day, I would say, like 5 students want to come and work with us, but we can't because we are understaffed. We are studying the urbanism of the new cities, so it's like big things. And the sustainability in the cities goes in various different directions. We studied the water with hydrofracking. This we studied 4 years ago. But we are really not well understood, even in this university. We are understaffed, underpaid, and underfunded. So I really am here open to accept any synergy that can come out from this. And then I latest thought, I would like to engage you in many more conversation, and I hope that we all find the space to continue this kind of conversation, because I have a bigger question. But my now suggestion that I synthesize in a phrase is, let's all of us vote with our fork.
Great idea. I like the slant. I like that. I would say that it's probably much more likely that you could find somebody in the administration with this kind of a crowd behind it that would say, yeah, we've got a roof somewhere. Why don't we let this become next semester's big agriculture or nutrition program? And I'd be more than happy to put my name on it and help find some funding and help put people together. I mean, if half the people in this room went somewhere tomorrow, like your office, and said they'd be likely to donate 100 hours, not just one day of their time, but 100 or 150 hours of their time, you'd be surprised how quickly you would get the New York Post up here to write about it, and then suddenly right after that is Mark Bittman, and then the New York Times is on it, and then you have not only a great idea, but a great idea with press. Then you have to go to work and actually do it, which is not as daunting as it seems if you have a large group of people. But the planning stages is just the first stage. When we're talking about something, we're talking about a 50-year program here. So we're behind. So let's get going.
All right. And so I think the first thing we want to ask you is the strategy to have all this done and done effectively. And then we continue the conversation.
Well, what I bring to the table is immediately a pretty large platform in the public eye, which is doesn't cost me very much, but it's certainly worth a lot. And that's what I really do. And if I can get behind things and love them and be a part of them and bring my kids up here and bring my employees up here, then we have a groundswell.
Also, Victory Garden started here at Teachers College, and the cookshop was an original program of Tony LaCorey at Teachers College. So we'll come right around. And
great.
Thank you very much.
So this summer, I worked for the restaurant industry in China, and one of the chief concerns was preserving the authenticity of their culture as food, but at the same time, like, embracing the new era of globalization and fusion. So I was curious as to your opinions and, like, what your observations have been and what you think the line is based off what you've seen and your experiences.
Well, I haven't been to China, but I'm going there this spring, and I'm going to open a restaurant in Hong Kong. I think one of the biggest and most interesting, certainly the biggest and most interesting market in the world is China, because they're going to have a middle class, and they're going to have a fascination like Western Europe did 40 years ago with American pop culture. And they're going to rush to try to become American pop culture, which means that Kentucky Fried Chicken, McDonald's, and Burger King are going to be the three biggest imports they can find as quickly as they can get their hands on it. I don't think they're in any danger of losing their regional deliciousness, but they probably are in danger of losing it as as the ability to make it attractive to someone who can eat that well at home. So if they want to be in the restaurant business, they have to somehow embrace something that's going to differentiate them from eating at their mom's house and offer them some kind of way to participate in something that's healthy and maybe perceived as kind of intellectually imported and thus hip and different. And that is that's a big thought, and it's a great idea. But they're going to eat, and they're going to eat a lot, and their middle class is going to go out to dinner, you know, once or twice a week, in a very different way than what we've ever seen before. So the large Monsantos and the big food companies are all over there trying to get their hands on that, because that's what they want to own. And that's the scariest part, is that it's not the thoughtful entrepreneur that's headed over there. It's the biggest, ugliest ones that are there first.
I think also, what's your favorite dish?
My favorite thing to eat is anything anyone else makes.
I think that's a good transition. I hear there are some pretty good recipes that someone else made for us in the reception. So I want to thank Columbia University, the Kraft family, and this has been a wonderful
Thank you, guys. Thank you.